day, viewers, and welcome to our second episode of PsorLifeTV. Last week, we talked about the basics of psoriasis, and today, we will dig deeper and talk about a hot topic nowadays, the so-called comorbidities of psoriasis. And to help us answer our questions, we have with us a distinguished guest from the Philippine Dermatological Society. She is very well loved by the psoriasis community, as she has helped us in our advocacy. She's also a past president of Philippine Dermatological Society and a medical advisor of Psoriasis Philippines. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Lorna Fernandez-Frez. Good day, Doctor. Doctor, last week we talked about the basics of psoriasis and we were able to gather information that there are new researches with regards to psoriasis, and this includes comorbidities. My question is, what is comorbidity?
Comorbidity refers to a disease that is together with another, because morbidity is defined as something that is abnormal or unhealthy. So co is a prefix that means with, so it's a combination of two disease states.
Why is there such a thing as comorbidity in psoriasis?
There are several reasons why comorbidities exist in psoriasis, and one of them, the first is a direct effect of the disease itself. Like, take for example depression. This comorbidity is common because psoriasis in itself, when the patient has this, can be depressing. Number two, genes. So there are the genes that may predispose one to developing psoriasis, maybe the very same genes that may predispose himself to having the development of the same another disease. Okay. And then three, there are common pathways in the development of the two diseases, psoriasis and the comorbidity. It's chemicals, substances, and cells that are involved in the development of the disease. Psoriasis may be the same substances, chemicals, and cells that are involved in another disease.
Okay.
And the last one is the side effect of treatment. There are treatments for psoriasis that may cause diseases, so when they coexist, they're called comorbidities.
Okay. So what are comorbidities of psoriasis, Doctor?
The comorbidities in psoriasis that are now being studied and have evidence already to say that it is really a comorbidity are cardiovascular disease or heart disease, hypertension, stroke, diabetes, obesity, fatty liver. These are the more common ones, but the less commonly there are, because of genes that are common, together with within the two, could be inflammatory bowel diseases like Crohn's disease, rheumatoid arthritis, and even lymphoma.
So which is the common comorbidity?
The most common is depression. There are not much statistics to prove this, but there are anecdotal reports that because of the impact of the disease on the psyche of the patient, psychological makeup, it's usually depression. It may be short-lived, it may be a chronic type of depression.
I see. Doctor, is there a chance that if this comorbidity is managed, psoriasis will not flare?
Yes. For one, about obesity, there are already published reports of weight loss, be it surgically with bariatric surgery or diet, that will improve the condition psoriasis. Patients tend to respond more to treatment if their weight is controlled. There are also some drugs that act as lipid lowering or fat lowering that are also used in cardiology and endocrinology to lower the incidence of atherosclerosis or clogging of the arteries. And these have also been experimented upon with regards to patients with psoriasis, looking at their effect on the skin itself. And it is positive that this is our early studies, by the way, so we need more evidence to corroborate the early findings. And also a drug for diabetes, we actually, in one study, they showed that indeed, aside from controlling blood sugar levels, it may improve psoriasis conditions.
Okay, Doctor, we'd like to go deeper into the comorbidities. And you mentioned earlier, one of the common comorbidities is the cardiovascular. How does this happen?
Well, first, for definition, for people who are not too familiar to the word cardiovascular, it means, cardio means heart, and vascular means vessels. So for the heart to function well, it has to have a good supply of blood, which the blood vessels bring to the heart, right? But the blood vessels can be diseased themselves. So this is what we call atherosclerosis, where you have fat deposits lining the walls of the vessel. So these become narrow, and so the flow may not be freely acceptable, I mean, free flowing to the heart, and so the heart will now begin to malfunction. So this is atherosclerosis. Now, not too long ago, they have found out that atherosclerosis, or the deposition of fat in the walls, are actually an inflammatory process. It's not plain deposition. So the inflammation there is similar. The pathways, the cells that are involved, are similar to the cells that are involved in psoriasis. So it's possible that they can coexist because of the shared chemicals involved in the pathway.
I see. How about the so-called metabolic syndrome? What is that about?
Metabolic syndrome is a group of conditions, abnormalities. You have to fulfill 3 out of the 5. So if you have abdominal obesity, so big baseline, elevated levels of what you call triglycerides, which is form of fat in the blood, and low good cholesterol, blood sugar that is elevated, and hypertension. So if you have any 3 out of the 5, or you are already taking medications for those conditions, then you fit in the that definition of metabolic syndrome.
But these diseases have genetic predisposition, right? So each disease leads to the other. My question, doctor, is this lead to psoriasis?
There is a linking, yes, there's a network of interactions, so one may lead to the other, but leading to psoriasis, there are still very few evidence. The one that has been studied is actually obesity. You know, in the US, they have a group of nurses, they look about 800 plus of them, who eventually were diagnosed with psoriasis. And because they were nurses, they had health records, that they had regular health data. And they looked at 14 years before, prior. Maybe they were not yet psoriatic then. And they looked at who among these patients, what were the factors that were associated with their development of psoriasis. And then they found out that increased body mass index, or BMI, is the weight, or in reference to the height. So that when they were becoming overweight and more so obese, they correlated positively with the onset or the occurrence of psoriasis. So that is one thing that is clear. But with regards to the other conditions, hypertension leading to psoriasis, or diabetes leading to psoriasis, there's not much evidence yet to say, but theoretically, yes, because of the common pathways and the interlinking, like a network of pathways, yes. But we have yet to see that. So future studies, so it's difficult to perform studies, research studies, showing the causation. That's a different matter when you say you study 1,000 patients with psoriasis and test whether they have hypertension existing at the moment in time. Okay, that's easy. But looking at the causation association, whether this came before and caused the psoriasis or the other way around, it's not easy to do. We're hoping to get something like that.
Alright. So is it true that some medications for this comorbidities can make the psoriasis flare, such as you mentioned, hypertension?
Okay. There are certain trigger factors for psoriasis, and one of them is drugs. And among that, we have antihypertensive medications called beta blockers, antidepressants, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents that are used for pain, for arthritis. So yes, theoretically it may, but I must have, I can console you by saying that not all, although these are drugs that may trigger psoriasis, it doesn't mean that each and every psoriasis patient who takes that drug will certainly have a flare-up. So there are some unexplained factors that may do this for one and not do this for the other. And if that happens, you go back to your doctor and ask for a substitute medication.
Doctor, which comes in first, the psoriasis or the comorbidity?
Again, that is a difficult question because these comorbidity things are not very old. Maybe just a decade old, and so we're still looking at evidence to expound on the problem. But that is again the obesity thing with the nurses. So it came before the psoriasis, and when they were overweight, the psoriasis developed. Okay, that is one thing that is black and white clear. However, with regards to other diseases, it's not yet proven. But because obesity is also linked with the other diseases, if you're obese, you're more prone to diabetes because of insulin resistance, you're more prone to hypertension, you're more prone to cardiovascular disease. It's possible that the obese patient with a cardiovascular disease already, not yet the psoriasis, or with the hypertension already, or with elevated blood lipids already, may eventually have psoriasis several years after that. It is possible, but you know, everything is not yet too clear.
Okay. But doctor, if my family has a history of diabetes or heart disease, does that mean that I'm prone to psoriasis, or is it the other way around since?
It's more clear that if you have moderate to severe uncontrolled psoriasis, then the risk for those comorbidities may be higher, especially so if you have a positive family history. But if you have parents with just diabetes or heart disease but no psoriasis, developing psoriasis is a little far-fetched. It's not that easy to get it.
But how will I know that I have this comorbidities? How? And would that be diagnosed easily?
Yeah. For one, obesity, that's easy to determine. If you have a large waist circumference, you measure it, and you can feel it if your clothes are getting tighter and tighter. And of course, the weighing scale is an easy tool that you can use. Of course, a regular checkup, hypertension, is easily detected with just a blood pressure reading, and also blood chemistries, your lipid profile, we call it. So these are things that are also done in an ordinary non-psoriatic patient. So the psoriatic patients now with that information that you are at risk, it is best to have these regular checkups too.
Doctor, we have some questions here from our viewers. First is from Lita de las Alas. Since PSOR is lifetime, what about PSOR patients' internal organ? What are they affected to?
Psoriasis is primarily a disease of the skin, the joints, that's why there's such a thing as psoriatic arthritis, and the nails. Sometimes mucous membranes are also affected, but as although we said that there are comorbidities of psoriasis, the diabetes and all these things, which may affect internal organs, it is not psoriasis per se. So you don't develop psoriasis of the colon, although sometimes there's also changes also in the eyes, but you don't call it psoriasis of the liver, but maybe fatty liver.
Okay, another is from Jesus de Robles. I was diagnosed last year with acoustic neuroma or head tumor with a size of 4 centimeters. And last year when I was diagnosed, my psoriasis flared up. I will undergo major surgery this coming year. What do you think will happen to my psoriasis after this major surgery? And my question here is, does psoriasis have something to do with acoustic neuroma, or is this independent from psoriasis?
There is no evidence yet today to show that there is a positive correlation between psoriasis and acoustic neuroma. It is possible, it might be coincidental when there was a flare-up of the psoriasis when the acoustic neuroma was diagnosed. Unless, of course, he was too stressed out. He had all these abnormal symptoms, and so he was too stressed thinking about them or whatever, the family or whatever. So it could be the stress that caused the flare-up. Now, with regards to surgery, depending on how extensive it is, how long the procedure will be, and how his body copes up with that form of stress. Surgery is a form of stress. So if his body copes up well with that surgical stress, then it is possible that the psoriasis will not flare up. But then again, if there are complications, if his body cannot take the complications of surgery and all these things, it is considered stressful, it may lead to a flare-up of his psoriasis.
From Grace Javierto, can psoriasis really increase the risk of skin cancer, just like we are prone to heart diseases?
Per se, psoriasis will not lead to skin cancer, but some treatments for psoriasis may predispose one or increase the risk for skin cancer, like phototherapy. But this is not a hard and fast rule. It may actually be dependent also on your skin prototype, the fairer skin you are, the dose that you've been receiving, the higher the dose, the longer your phototherapy, etc. This may lead to skin cancer, especially if you're also taking in cyclosporine or together, so that is discouraged actually. So it may increase the risk of skin cancer. This is more treatment related rather than the disease itself leading to skin cancer.
From Asai Aoki, she would like to clarify, is psoriasis a skin disorder or a result of underlying disease?
It is primarily a skin disorder, but of course it also affects the joints, as I mentioned.
Okay. From Milu, is there a link between psoriasis and estrogen levels? I notice I flare up before and after my monthly period. Can you consider ovarian cysts or any disease associated with the reproductive system as comorbidity of psoriasis?
Yes, there is a link between hormones and psoriasis, primarily estrogen. Estrogen is considered protective. There is a study that of female patients with psoriasis, they follow them through when they got pregnant, and more than 50%, about 55% of these women actually cleared up or improved during pregnancy. But unfortunately, when after delivery, within as early as 6 weeks after delivery, the lesions came back. And this was also correlated with elevated estrogen levels. So during pregnancy, there is really elevation of estrogen levels. Premenstrually, estrogen levels dip or go down. Okay, so that's why when you have lower estrogen levels, you may get a flare up. So also after delivery, the previously elevated levels of estrogen now go down back to normal, so the lesions come back. But with regards to ovarian cysts and psoriasis, again, there are no published reports showing the positive link between the two.
Thank you very much, Dr. Frez, for helping us inform the public what psoriasis is and how it affects a patient with psoriasis. Any final reminders to our viewers now?
Okay, I'd like to say that with all the information that I provided to you regarding comorbidities for psoriasis, I hope it will not scare you. It's not meant to give you more depression, but it's actually a reminder for you to be more healthy, live a healthy lifestyle, do checkups regularly, and treat them as early as possible. And consider it a blessing on your part that you're able to monitor with more diligence, because you know you are at risk compared to someone who doesn't have psoriasis and freely drinking and smoking and living a bad lifestyle, and it becomes too late for them to reverse when they get all these bad diseases.
At this point, we would like to thank Geopharma Philippines, Galderma Philippines, and Janssen Philippines for the educational grant that they have provided to make PsorLifeTV possible. Please do watch out for the next episode of PsorLifeTV next Sunday, where we will talk about diet and psoriasis. You may still send us your questions to our Facebook fan page. Good day, everyone, and be a blessing to others. Catch us again next Sunday. This has been Edwin De Guzman for PsorLifeTV.